Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the webinar that's today, the 29th of June. It's 2022, but when we came to look at the publicity for this event, 29th of June 2021, to the day we had the legal update last year. So that year has just flown. I'm sorry that we're not in person, but welcome to this afternoon. We've got a great panel this afternoon for you. Delighted that District Judge John Beckley has agreed to join us, and he's here and to have this webinar recorded. You will have all clicked your agreement for the webinar to be recorded. What District Judge Beckley says won't be recorded. And before we hear from his judicial perspective, we're going to hear in the order of speaking from Bethan Harris, then Stephen Simblet, Queen's Counsel, and then Ollie Persey. I'll introduce them in due course, but just to let you know that this recording and the slides that accompany the webinar will be circulated to you after the event. And there will, of course, be time for questions. Please use the Q&A function on your screen rather than the chat function so that we can pick up the questions as we go through. So first of all, I'm going to ask Bethan, who's going to speak on capacity. Bethan, very well established and I'm sure known to all of you as an established court of protection, community care and housing practitioner. Also on the panel for the as counsel for the Equality and Human Rights Commission, and is going to give us her update on capacity. Thanks very much, Bethan.
Thank you very much for that introduction, and thanks very much for joining us. I'm going to highlight some recent cases on capacity over the last 12 months, and I'm also going to look at a case which is perhaps an introduction to what is the next topic on our programme, which is best interests, which is the case of Secretary for Justice against a local authority. With regards to capacity, the cases that I've picked out to highlight from the last 12 months are, first of all, the decision of the Supreme Court in the case of JB, which is to do with sexual relations, and then some first instance decisions which concern the distinguishing between an unwise decision and an incapacitous one, capacity in relation to termination and capacity in relation to decisions on contact. The decision in the case of a local authority against JB, the decision of the Supreme Court, arose from the situation of JB, who was a person who had difficulties with developmental and social developmental difficulties and social functioning. His problem specifically, which was relevant in the case, was that he had difficulty understanding or interpreting the intentions of other people and understanding their perspectives. And as a result, he was assessed as not being able to understand that another person, if he was having sexual relations with another person, that that other person would need to give their consent would need to be able to give their consent to having sexual relations. And that was the issue in the case. It was whether the fact that the other person engaging in sexual relations must be able to consent and does in fact consent. It's whether that is relevant information for the purposes of Section 3 of the Mental Capacity Act, i.e., is it necessary that P, the person in question who whose capacity is in doubt, is it necessary that P is able to understand, use or weigh that information about the other person in order to make a capacitous decision to engage in sexual relations? And as you'll be aware, it's important background to this area of decision making that if a person is assessed as lacking capacity in relation to a decision to engage in sexual relations, that no best interest decision can be made. so the person wouldn't be able to have sexual relations. So obviously it's a very important determination with regards to a person's capacity. At first instance, the court held that whether the other person can consent and does in fact consent to engaging in sexual relations was not part of the relevant information. So that was a decision which was helpful for JB. But the Court of Appeal decided otherwise, having recast the decision as a decision to engage in sexual relations rather than a decision to consent to sexual relations. And once it was put in that formulation, the court fairly readily concluded that part of the relevant information was being able to understand, use and weigh the fact that the other person must consent and consents at all times. So the matter went further to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court made some pronouncements about the general principles in relation to capacity assessments, which are not new matters, but are really helpful matters of emphasis about the way sections 1 to 3 of the Mental Capacity Act work. The burden of proof being on the person asserting that a person does not have capacity, the balance of probabilities being the balance of proof, and characterising section 2.3, which requires that all practicable steps are taken to enable a person to make a decision for him or herself, as a statutory condition, which if not satisfied would mean that it would not be established that the person does lack capacity. And then underlying the importance of section 1.4, which is that there must be a distinction between an incapacitous decision and an unwise decision, flagging that as a principle of autonomy, so really underlining its importance. And then a useful observation about the timing of capacity assessments. Obviously, a person's capacity is assessed at the time of the decision that needs to be made. But when in court, the court is being asked to make the determination, what we have there is a general forward-looking assessment at the date of the hearing. Moving on to what was said about capacity in relation to decisions to have sexual relations, the Supreme Court said that generally it's a general determination of capacity, whether a person has decision-making capacity in general, but it can sometimes be a person-specific test in certain circumstances. That would be the exception, but that is possible. And then went on to hold that it wasn't too abstract to require that the relevant information includes that P must understand that the other person, their sexual partner, must be able to consent and does consent. The final conclusion of the court is there in the final bullet point that this is part of the relevant information. So that was the clear decision of the Supreme Court on that matter of relevant information in relation to decisions to engage in sexual relations. So I'm now going to look at some first instance decisions. Obviously, these are not new points. They're not precedents as such, but they've been picked out because they highlight certain aspects of the way the Mental Capacity Act works in relation to capacity assessments that might be useful to look at for practitioners and helpful when thinking about how we might want to argue a case or formulate our arguments. This case is the case of Lancashire and South Cumbria NHS Foundation Trust against Kew, decision of Mr. Justice Hayden in February of this year. It concerns the litigation capacity and subject matter capacity, that distinction, and also looks at the issue of using and weighing and how a mental disorder might impact on that, and the distinction between an unwise decision and an incapacitous decision. And Kew had bulimia nervosa, and there came a point where she decided that she would wanted to refuse treatment for a life-threatening condition that resulted from bulimia. She had various diagnoses, including an emotionally unstable personality disorder. And there was disagreement between the experts as to whether she lacked capacity to make the decision about her treatment and a specialist psychiatrist in eating disorder psychiatry differed from the other clinicians in the case in his view that she did lack capacity because she had pervasively low self-esteem and a sense of hopelessness, which was a result of her emotionally unstable personality disorder. And that fundamentally impacted on her ability to weigh matters of life in the balance. But nevertheless, it was accepted that this was a finely balanced case. And the court found that she had litigation capacity and then made some observations about how litigation capacity is not the same thing as subject matter capacity and took a slightly different approach to Mr. Justice Most in another recent case of an NHS against P, which suggested that they were virtually the same, that one would follow from the other. He drew a line between them. Nevertheless, in most cases where a person lacks subject matter capacity, they are highly likely to lack litigation capacity. Q didn't lack litigation capacity. She also didn't lack, as it was found, she didn't lack subject matter capacity. And it was held that to whatever extent she may have exhibited low self-esteem and a sense of worthlessness, it was not to the extent that it prevented her from making a capacitous decision. And so the distinction was made here between a clearly unwise decision and a very sad decision and a decision that was incapacitous, and really kind of highlights the very, very careful dissection of the way in which a person has personally come to the conclusion that they've come to in order to decide on which side of the line their decision falls on, even though it may be a very unwise, as it clearly was, unwise decision. It is their decision to make. The next case is, again, first instance decision of Her Honour Judge Hilda, sitting as Deputy High Court Judge, concerns capacity in relation to a decision on a termination. S was 38 weeks pregnant. She'd become pregnant with IVF. She had stated that she wanted to have a child before she reached 40. Having become pregnant, she became unwell mentally and she wanted to have a termination. And she was not 100% sure, but she thought that she did probably want to have a termination. The hospital felt that she didn't have capacity to make the decision and that it was in her best interests not to have a termination. She herself brought the matter before the court, and Her Honour Judge Hilda, in circumstances of great urgency, looked very carefully at the way in which S had come to the decision that she'd come to. And on that careful consideration, was able to identify that S had her own rationale for her decision, which held up under analysis. So it's kind of the sort of dispassionate analysis under the structure of the Mental Capacity Act sections 1 to 3, and that it wasn't a decision that could be vitiated as one that was incapacitous. And the way the analysis was explained was very clear in paragraph 58, that the judge was satisfied that S had enough pieces of the jigsaw to see the whole picture, even if aspects of her weighing are influenced by symptoms of her diagnosed condition. The judge was not satisfied, and of course the burden of proof is on the person who's alleging the incapacity. The judge was not satisfied that she was unable to use or weigh the information relevant to the decision, rather that she was demonstrating her own values. And there are a number of points of interest in this case, and I won't be able to refer to them all, but one of them is that the NHS bodies should have actually brought the case to court in accordance with the president's guidance on serious medical treatment. It shouldn't have been for P herself to bring the matter to court. Very quickly, on the case of ZK, this is the decision of His Honour Judge Burrows, and it's of interest because of two reasons. It concerns capacity and contact, and there was expert evidence with regards to ZK's capacity. It was said that he wasn't able to assess risk. It was also said that he didn't appreciate that he could make a decision. He lacked a sense of agency, and that he was only just learning that decisions were for him to make. It was argued that he was able to make decisions in relation to his contact with his family, but not with others, because he was familiar with his family. But the court held that this wasn't a case where contact, his capacity to make decisions on contact with other people, should be decided differently with regards to his family as opposed to other people. Although there are some cases in which there is a proper evidential foundation for making separate determinations on decision making regarding contact with regards to one group of people or one person as opposed to another group of people. And so that can happen, but this wasn't such a case. There wasn't an evidential basis for it. And in any event, the situation with regards to, sorry, I need to move slides. Oh, I seem to have got stuck. All right, just bear with me. There we go. The end of any event situation with regards to ZK was that he didn't appreciate that he had a decision to make, but this was something that over time might change. So my final case in this section is to make a brief mention of the Secretary of State for Justice and a local authority. This isn't a capacity case. This is more linked to the best interests heading because it's essentially about care planning. And it's to do with when a care planning for a person lacking mental capacity because they have a mental disorder might fall foul of Section 39 of the Sexual Offences Act. And that act provides that if a care worker intentionally causes or incites another person to engage in sexual activity, that person has a mental disorder, that this can constitute a criminal offence. And I obviously just dealing with the case very briefly, it's the decision of the Court of Appeal. Ultimately, C had a syndrome resulting in communication difficulties, developmental delays. C asked his advocate if contact could be made with a sex worker on his behalf, and the case was brought before the court in order to determine whether it would be lawful for arrangements to be made for C to meet with a sex worker. The arrangements would be made by his carers, the sex worker would be paid by his carers, because although C had capacity to engage in sexual relations and to decide to meet a sex worker, he didn't have the ability or capacity to make the arrangements. The decision of at first instance was that that would not be a breach. The decision on the Court of Appeal was that it would be a breach of Section 39, i.e. a breach of the criminal law. It would be causing or inciting a person with a mental disorder to have sexual relations. It was a question of whether the acts in question create circumstances in which something might happen, or do they cause it in a legal sense? And this was over the line in causing it in a legal sense. And the court went on to look at other circumstances that might be on the other side of the line and wouldn't constitute a criminal offence. Now, that's it from me. That's only dealing in a very cursory way with what is a very important and interesting case. But I'll have to leave it there. And I'm afraid hand you back will, to Helen. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Beth. And that was great hearing those cases really being brought very clearly to life. Thank you very much for that. We're going to move now to hear from Stephen Simblet, Queen's Counsel, an expert civil liberties practitioner in the areas of mental health and cultural protection, and also dealing with inquests. Where the death has occurred in hospital. I'm very grateful to Stephen, particularly because when this webinar was first advertised, Mailing Savage was due to speak, and at relatively short notice, Stephen was able to make himself available to join us and share his expertise. I'm really grateful to him. Over to you, Stephen, to deal with best interests. Thank you.
Right, well, hello everyone. I'm just going to set up the sharing. Hang on. I'm not going to do it because I never can practice it about 10 seconds ago. There we go. We've got five recent cases on best interest, picking up the best interest thread.
To interrupt for a second, Stephen, just in case you think that the screen is...
No, I don't think I'm sharing slides. Okay. No, I'm just trying to... Fine. I'm talking on while I solve my technical problem.
Right, okay.
The, um, We've got five recent cases. There's already one that Bethan's mentioned on best interests, which is the extent to which the state and the courts can intervene in your sex life, as they did in the case. And essentially, the five recent best interest cases that are selected here are not selected just because they raise issues of important principle or anything like that. They're being selected because they essentially show some of the mundaneness of some of these decisions, yet at the same time, their importance. Hang on, my slideshow is now saying it's not responding. It's not even doing real one, is it? I'll move to my next slide that at least I can see. No, I can't even do that. Sorry about this, everyone. This is I had this all lined up, all queued up, as if I were Professor Witty or whoever from last year. But I think we're going to have to restart the slides. Here we are. Look, here we are. Anushka's going to save the day. So yeah, could you start with the first slide, please? What's going on there?
I think here it comes.
I think. Are the slides up there yet? I can't see them there.
Yes, I can see a version of them.
Sorry about this, everyone. This is not the slick transfer of a handover of power that was practiced when we were doing this earlier. We have done our practice. I can't see the slides now. I mean, are they? Here they are, right.
Here they are. Thanks very much, Anusha. Over to you, Steve.
Thanks, Anusha. Yeah, right. So five recent cases. Let's move to the next one, please. And what we're looking, essentially, as I was just saying, this is the mundaneness of some of the things that are, go back one. Can we go over to the second slide? Not that one. Right, there we are. Hooray. Right. Best interest decision making. And as you see on the bottom bullet point there, essentially what we're talking about is a range of things that are crop up in the court in a number of ways over a whole range of important issues in people's life. And as Judge Burroughs, who's been mentioned already, said in the MM case, the very issue was not so much the point of legal principle, but the very normality of the case, the routine nature of it, which masked, in his words, the profound nature of the decisions being considered. So, well, I'll move to BU. Now, this is a case about coercive control it's essentially the court intervening in a situation where, I suppose to use old-fashioned language, P had got involved with a wrong'un. And P's family was concerned about the extent to which the wrong'un was misusing her resources and spending all her money, and he'd sold all her assets, all this sort of stuff. And the problem for the court or for the judge in BU was that P very much enjoyed the company and society and relationship with BU and would be very upset at the court putting the restrictions that it was going to on it. And essentially, the problem that then the problem was that the court was going to stop BU being as involved in P's life, and indeed granted injunctions and started following the procedure under the forced marriage protection orders and procedures and so on, but essentially tempered that by drawing attention to the temporary nature of the orders and also the fact that P was to be given assistance to cope with this intervention in her life. So it's essentially the court making what seem to be quite coercive orders, but putting in place their measures to deal with those. Can we move to the next slide, please? Because I just need to crack on. Now, this is a case about delay, where in fact the delay was so profound that by the time we got to the actual reasoned, detailed judgment, he had already died. But it's a case that involves important issues. It's the Northwest London Commissioning Group and GU case involving who takes best interests decisions and what should be the or what is involved in issues around withdrawal of artificial nutrition and hydration. And P was being essentially kept alive in circumstances that the judge decided he would not have wanted to be kept alive in. And the concern was that essentially this family disagreement had delayed the actual exercise of a proper best interest decision in a circumstance where, as the last bullet point on that slide says, it was pellucidly clear that the obligation to review best interests falls on the people providing the care, and they'd all got bogged, and which was the clinicians who got bogged down in this family dispute. And one of the interesting features about the reasons judgment given in the end is to draw attention to the difference between what is essentially involved in clinically assisted nutrition and hydration, and to distinguish the fact that it's not simply giving people nutrition and hydration. A patient or a person who is receiving that level of intervention has no longer any ability to choose their own food. So essentially the sort of artificial clinic factor that it's not being fed and it's not choosing your food or your diet, it was being essentially kept artificially alive. That's quite important to the whole nature of the decisions being taken. So if we can move to the next slide, please. Now, this is the MM case that I mentioned right at the start, Judge Burrows. And this is a case that shows the problems where or how the court will try to deal with essentially choosing the worst of two. Choosing the better. Of what seemed could be quite seriously intractable problems, because MM had a number of things that he liked doing that people didn't want him to do, such as he liked drinking a lot and all of this sort of stuff. And he also would abscond and threaten staff. And as you can see, one of the fairly graphic pieces of evidence in the case was that MM had said, "I'm my own person, I can do what I want. I like to know the judges. I'll smash his head in. I'm not a person to be fucked around with," and had threatened to headbutt the one of the professionals involved. I put a little wry note at the bottom there that will consider that sort of encounter when we come to what the court has to say about the court's role in visiting people and so on. But if we can move on to the next slide, we'll see what happened in MM, which is that on the Section 21A application, essentially the court decided, perhaps quite sensibly, and perhaps because the judge didn't want to get his head smashed in, was that it would be better for MM to be able to go out and associate with people and do the things that professionals didn't want him to do, because the alternative was that he'd be so resentful, angry, and stressed that he would cause all sorts of problems in where he lived, and it would actually impact very markedly on the quality of his life. So essentially, the best interest balance lay very much in letting this bloke do more of what he wanted to do rather than what professionals and social workers and so on thought would be in his general best welfare. Can we move to the next slide, please? Yes, now this is another case that emphasizes that it essentially the court has to start with P and what P would want, and also look at where P is in their life. So just as in the artificial nutrition hydration case we're looking at, P, the sort of very dependent position P was in, having been a pilot, is something that the court thought he wouldn't want to be like. He wouldn't want to be like in this case. P was very elderly and didn't have long to go. Essentially, as the top bullet point says, And the issue, the dispute in the case was between family who wanted him to carry on living in the care home in which he was living, family who wanted him to move to a care home where his Jewish religion would be much better facilitated, because it was a Jewish care home. And essentially there was a lot of evidence that he enjoyed the religious practices and rites and rituals and so on of the Jewish faith, and that actually being able to do more of that would be better for him than the risks to his life and well-being that a disruptive move might cause. So if we can have the next slide. So District Judge Eldergill thought that, you know, as I've said at the top there, the short life expectancy was in fact a very important factor, or rather the turn it on its head, keeping him alive and maximizing his life expectancy was not the magnetic consideration in the case. And that's quite important, looking at who P is, what P wants, and looking at life as actually what you can get out of it, and what it has of value, rather than just prolonging it, however, in a rather less rewarding and drab way. And that's quite often the approach District Judge Eldergill has taken. I was in a case where we had a very elderly lady where the local authority were concerned about her poor diet choices, but actually we were able to persuade him that actually, you know, one of the few pleasures she had left was eating what she liked. So why mess about with it? And this is essentially the same sort of thinking, but in religious needs and so on. So can we move on to the next slide, please? Yes, now this is withdrawal of life-sustaining treatment. And what we had, it is AH, which I made a wry observation about in the MM case earlier. Essentially, this was a case in which P was very, very ill, receiving life-sustaining treatment, and various submissions made on behalf of the trust and on the OS and all of that, the usual. But after the hearing had concluded, Mr. Justice Hayden, for it was he, visited AH in hospital, found her there distressed and crying, and said to her, I think it may be you want some peace, and thought he was getting the message. So made orders that essentially her ventilation should be withdrawn from her and that she be allowed to die. Now, there are all sorts of problems and difficulties with that approach, not least the fact that just because the judge turns up when P is sick, around in distress and crying, that may not be the either representative or indeed something that the judge has any particular skills or knowledge in dealing with. And in particular, the judge had done this after the argument had been heard, without anybody having an opportunity to make submissions about what, if any, value should be placed on this interaction between the judge and P. And what then happened was that it went to the Court of Appeal. We'll move to the next slide. And the Court of Appeal was very concerned that although the judge had set out in a lot of detail all the considerations and so on, one of the real problems was the lack of, the consideration as to whether he was equipped to gain such insight, and the real problem being that nobody had the opportunity properly to address it. So then it was ordered there be a rehearing, and for completeness, the reference to the rehearing before Mrs. Justice Tice is at the bottom of the slide. And that leads to the consideration of what the guidance is to judges in these sorts of cases. There was existing guidance from Mr. Justice Charles that was adverted to in the AH case, and that has been revisited and restated in a judicial visits section promulgated in February of this year, and sets out the various things that should be expected to be worked out and thought about before a visit takes place, to define what the purpose of the visit is, and essentially to prevent the judge thinking that he or she has got some sort of superpowers to be able to divine what P wants over and above all of what the submissions and representations have been made. So that's now important guidance that perhaps Mr. Justice Hayden wishes he'd thought more about before he went to the bedside of P in AH. So I think, can we have the next slide? I think that's towards the end there. Yes, there we are. Thank you. And I can go and thank you for bearing with us through my technical difficulties as well. I've been rather, normally you can see what's coming next on the slides, but I've been having to sort of base it on the memory. So I'll now hand over to the next one. Thanks so much.
Thanks very much, Stephen, for that, all that illumination. I'm going to turn now to Ollie Persey, public law practitioner with very active court protection practice, formerly with the Public Law Project. And he's going to continue the best interest theme, dealing with some COVID cases and then looking at deprivation of liberty. So thanks very much, Ollie. And I'm going to turn to you.
Thanks very much, Helen. So I'm going to split my presentation in two. The first part will be in relation to COVID-19 vaccinations and touch on a few recent cases that apply the principles in SD. Then I'll be moving on to deprivation of liberty cases. I will be going at quite a canter, but you will have my slides and the more detailed information will be on there. Turning to, I've got to set my timer so I come in on time. Turning to COVID vaccination, the situation still is as set out by Mr. Justice Hayden in the case of SD, which we actually covered a year ago today at the COP update webinar, which Helen reminded us was exactly a year ago today when there was a big football match on immediately after, or indeed at the same time. So those are the four principles. The best interest assessment is not confined to the evidence of the health benefits and risks of vaccination. It involves a wide review and comes with all the relevant circumstances, applying the usual tests under the Mental Capacity Act. In relation to the benefits and risks to the health of P from vaccination, essentially the court is not there to arbitrate medical controversy. The court of protection is somewhat frustrated by people using individual challenges to challenge the national guidance. That is not their role. It will consider whether there will be contraindications based on medical impact or potentially the distress of actually administering the vaccination. And while disagreements amongst family members about how P should be vaccinated or not vaccinated, it's again not suitable challenge, not a suitable forum for concerns with the national vaccination program, wider concerns about the government's handling of COVID to be ventilated. So the three cases that I'm going to be focusing on are set out below. And the key facts of NHS Liverpool CCG against X. X was a 50-year-old woman with a diagnosis of severe epilepsy and mild learning difficulties. Crucially and most interestingly about this case, she had already been infected based on the fact she had antibodies to COVID-19 and seemingly had not suffered severe consequences, which gave the medical expert in this case pause for thought about, when doing their best interest assessment, actually, if she's had it and been fine previously, would, how important is that in the best interest balancing exercise? Ultimately, despite the court taking into account the sort of apparent drop in severity of COVID, fewer number of cases, it recognized that that was partly due, or in large part due, to the vaccination program. And as I put in that quote there, learning to live with the virus does not mean that we should now ignore it or neglect it. And it should the default is essentially the vaccine, unless there are good reasons not to, as set out in SD. In the case of E, E was a male in his 60s with a moderate to severe learning disability. Now, the fact of this case, he had whooping cough and as a child, and the vaccination caused serious side effects to him previously. And that was part of those representing him's case around why he should not receive the vaccination now. As already stated, the court generally goes to the case of SD as the starting point when looking at COVID vaccination issues. And it did not think it was an appropriate forum for it to challenge to national guidance. However, it can be a forum for why the national guidance should not apply to P in those specific circumstances. And those are set out in detail on the slide. I'm going to trot on now because of the interest of time, and you will get the slides. One thing I should highlight about this case is the court was in no way convinced by medical evidence. And again, it goes back to the SD point about it not being a forum to adjudicate controversial medical disputes, is that there was expert evidence presented that vitamins would be a way of treating COVID-19. That was given short shrift by the court. In the case of FZ, FZ was in her 40s, British Muslim and South Asian heritage with a learning disability and suspected asthma. The judge clearly had great difficulty in deciding this case. And as you can see, paragraph 63 to 65, which encompassed the key reasoning in the judgment, in favor of P medically receiving the vaccination, but not in agreement with the plan put forward by the CCG for doing so. As put quite bluntly, I wonder what the proposed plan actually amounts to. So the plan was that P would be befriended over a series of visits by a vaccinator to build trust. And then on a subsequent visit, the vaccinator would essentially take P by surprise and issue a swift injection that would ideally be minimally traumatic for P. The court was not convinced that was an effective strategy, not least because there was a possibility that the family might prevent that from happening. And in the circumstances where P had previously been a vaccine resistor and had had difficulties in being subjected to medical treatment or restraint. Taking all of those factors into account, although it was finally balanced, the judge decided on this case they would not approve the applicant's order and essentially sent the applicant back to come up with a better care plan for administering the vaccine. I'm now going to move on to deprivation of liberty, and this is going to take up the majority of my time. I'm briefly going to mention the seminal Supreme Court case of Ree T, not only because it's a seminal case on the inherent jurisdiction and when it can be used to authorise deprivation of liberty of vulnerable children, but several colleagues from Garden Court were involved in this case, and I feel like the marketing team would have done a dirty by not mentioning such a key case. In essence, this case is one where the Supreme Court very begrudgingly authorised the use of the inherent jurisdiction, which is in the family division rather than the Court of Protection, obviously, to authorise non-regulated placements for accommodating vulnerable children. And it was seen as the inherent jurisdiction was seen as the ultimate safety net for the court to be able to intervene to prevent further harm being visited upon a vulnerable child. I'm going to brush over the detailed reasoning of this because it doesn't actually go into the nuts and bolts of deprivation of liberty, application of deprivation of liberty principles, in the which is meant to be the focus of my presentation. But the key points from RE-T are on the slides and can be revisited at another time. I'm going to take you through a few examples of how the family division has, or the inherent jurisdiction has been used in relation to vulnerable children. And the case of F, a child, is a useful example of when a deprivation of liberty actually occurs and when it's in the best interest for this deprivation to be authorised, because both points were in dispute before the court. The crux of the facts here is F, or Fiona, as she's referred to in the judgment, was a 14.5-year-old girl at the time with a long history of poor mental health with multiple suicide attempts. She became a looked after child in 2019. She was subsequently detained under section 136. Care proceedings followed, engaged and supportive parents who felt it was out of their hands and they needed support from a local authority. Following an ASD diagnosis, she was moved to a children's home and it seemed that she was making some progress there. Mother and also F, Fiona, opposed the order authorising deprivation of liberty, principally on the basis that the care home was not actually depriving F of her liberty. Questions were raised about whether the regime at the children's home and the restrictions currently placed actually amounted. The argument was put that just because the restrictions may become necessary in the future did not necessarily mean that such an order was required now. And key points that were considered by the court was that actually Fiona had access to the grounds using her fob. She was allowed to be unsupervised for extended periods of time, didn't really have her belongings searched, and she hadn't been subject to physical restraint for a long period of time. And given the progress that Fiona had made, such restraints on her liberty were not proportionate or necessary. The judge heard from Fiona and was clearly impressed by her. And a very sad case, she had been subject to restrictions since the age of 12. And one of the key points that the judge bore in mind was that Fiona actually had not attempted to take her own life for 18 months. The rest of the facts are listed here. One of the concerns that Fiona raised, which I think is interesting, is that an authorization of deprivation of liberty might lead to a leveling up, as it were, or if you authorize restrictions, they become the go-to or default and it risks them being used more. This is a reminder of the key principles on the right to liberty and reference the United Nations Convention on the Child. So the judgment is clear. The due amount, the deprivation of liberty that was actually in situ at the time amounted to a deprivation of liberty. She was not allowed to leave the perimeter of the property and her access to the outside areas had to be earned and could be withdrawn at any time. 15 minutes was not a significant length of time, and there was CCTV around restricting it. Ordinarily, a 14-year-old, and the judge seemed to be taking judicial notice of this, would not be locked to prevent her from leaving. And the judge seemed to have difficulty with the arguments of the mother, which said that actually she was less restrictive than many of the other children in the care home just because that evidence had not been presented to the court. Although the judge bore in mind that Fiona hadn't attempted to take her own life recently, that she had in a not too distant past made an attempt was of serious concern. And any risk of that happening needed to be an important consideration when it came to the question of proportionality of that deprivation of liberty. What the judge did bear in mind, taking into account the progress Fiona was making and the concerns about deprivation of liberty being that were not proportionate or necessary, was to curtail the length of time that it would be for, and opted for the somewhere between the two of the May and September options put forward, but so May option and the 12-month option put forward by the other side. The judge went out of his way, and I think in response to Fiona's concerns, and the judgment is written in a way that is meant to be accessible to Fiona, these are permissive, not a requirement, and they should not be a target, but only be used when necessary. I'm very briefly going to go through this case. I'm conscious of the time and creeping away. This is a desperately sad case concerning a child with very complex special educational needs and a local authority that had completely messed up, Manchester City Council. The judge is extremely scathing in his critique of what they have done here. Indeed, the application which should properly be made by a local authority was made by the NHS Trust. To give you an indication of the level of need that ST had, her EHCP required 6-to-1 support in the classroom. That is about 3 times as much as the maximum support I've ever seen in an EHCP. It's truly astonishing. Her siblings had to lock themselves in a room because they were so scared of physical harm. I'm going to canter through the next slide, but ultimately the court of Mr. Justice MacDonald here is clear, and referring to a previous case that he of Wigan Borough Council against Y, that came down just after the case of Re-T, and unfortunately wasn't referred to in Re-T. What will happen when a local authority proposes a manifestly unsuitable placement? In this case, it was a hospital which could not look after her and where she was subject to repeated restraints by security guards. What will now happen to that person? The answer is the local authority simply must find them an alternative placement. The court, in exercising its inherent jurisdiction, is not going to visit upon a vulnerable child something that is actively harmful to them. And that is the nub of this judgment. I'm going through quickly because I'm short of time, but the court is clear. While Re-T might have suggested that it will bear in mind a lack of approved regulated accommodation and will authorise non-regulated accommodation, the inherent jurisdiction is not some wild west which will authorise anything where the local authority simply says they don't have alternatives. If it is actively harmful, it will not authorise a deprivation of liberty and will send a local authority back to find a better placement for a child. It's striking that next week, well-timed, but I guess the seminar is, that next week a new deprivation of liberty court is being launched in relation to vulnerable children. And that is in response to the massive uptick in the use of the inherent jurisdiction for children, different from the inherent jurisdiction for adults, which Bethan is going to be speaking to in a minute. From 108 in the 2017 to 2018 year to 579 in the 2021-2022 year. And it's launching soon. There's more information on the judiciary page. I briefly want to touch on the case of Miklic against Croatia, which is a recent Strasbourg case. And I wanted to touch upon this case principally because of its relevance to the new LPS, which will be replacing the deprivation of liberty safeguard scheme. Now, LPS provides for up to 3 years of deprivation of liberty in what will replace the standard authorization form. Here, the European Court of Human Rights is making clear that it's unconvinced that there could be sufficiently cogent medical evidence and recent medical evidence to authorize deprivation of liberty if the evidence is 1 to 2 years old. As it said, as I've highlighted there, the court is not convinced that either of those expert opinions could be considered both objective and recent within the meaning of the court's case law in relation to Article 5, 1E. So essentially, fresh medical evidence is going to be needed, and extended deprivation of liberty going straight to the 3 years under LPS might not be lawful. And just in time, I have finished. So thank you very much. I'll hand back to Helen.
Thanks very much, Ollie. And thanks for mentioning LPS, the consultation, which was due to expire on the, or conclude on the 7th of July, has now been extended to the 14th of July for people who want to respond to those proposals. As you alluded to, Ollie, we're going to now go to Bethan to deal with inherent jurisdiction and some other practice points. Thanks very much, Bethan.
Thank you. I'm going to be very quick because we're going to be handing over to District Judge Beckley very soon. So I'm going to just make a few final points in this part of our webinar, mentioning a couple of cases relating to practice and procedure and highlighting the draft updated code of practice to the MCA, and then referring to the inherent jurisdiction of the High Court for the protection of vulnerable adults, which is of course not the Court of Protection. This webinar has been billed as a Court of Protection webinar, but we're actually here talking about a different jurisdiction. Ollie took us through cases which are dealing with deprivation of liberty, obviously in the inherent jurisdiction of the High Court in relation to children. So again, stepping a bit to the side of Court of Protection there as well. Here again, I'll be taking you to the inherent jurisdiction of the High Court, this time in relation to vulnerable adults as opposed to children. So to deal with those matters then, briefly, the first case is not a new point of law, really just highlights how a type of case might be case managed. Reaffirms that the jurisdiction of the Court of Protection can be engaged in circumstances where P, the subject of the proceedings, is currently detained under the Mental Health Act. And nevertheless, the Court of Protection proceedings are relevant to P with regards to discharge arrangements, quite often specifically that the arrangements that are anticipated for P will amount to a deprivation of liberty in the community, that requiring authorization by the Court of Protection, requiring a best interest determination then to be the foundation of that. Hence we have situations where we are in Court of Protection proceedings whilst P is detained under the Mental Health Act. But in some circumstances, as was the case in PH, it might be considered that the discharge process is not yet imminent enough for those Court of Protection proceedings to be appropriate. And that was the case management decision that was made in the case of PH. So really just underlying some sort of case management principles. The next case is a reaffirmation of the breadth of the court's power to grant injunctions in order to give effect to its orders. And that is quite a broad power. It's in section 16.5 of the Act. And I think the precise wording there is where it's expedient to do so. I'm sorry, I haven't got the precise phrase to hand, but it's a wide jurisdiction, and the court here, Mr. Justice Hayden, did not accept an argument that the jurisdiction should be construed more narrowly, and granted injunctions that were to regulate behaviour or family members in a hospital where there was very poor relations sadly had developed between the parents and hospital staff in what were obviously very pressing circumstances. So they're basically a confirmation of the breadth of the power of the Court of Protection to grant injunctions in order to enforce its orders. I mentioned the code of practice, which will be updated, contains many very useful new updating provisions in the draft, and that consultation is underway. And I'm going to mention very briefly indeed now the inherent jurisdiction for protection of vulnerable adults. So this is not the Court of Protection's jurisdiction, but it is not infrequently the case that a case starts off in the Court of Protection and moves over to this jurisdiction or vice versa, where a person doesn't lack capacity under the Mental Capacity Act in respect of the relevant decision, but their decision may have been vitiated by other factors, by undue influence or other circumstances such that they are not, for some reason, not able to freely make a decision for themselves, then those are circumstances where this part of the inherent jurisdiction may be triggered. This jurisdiction has been referred to, I think Stephen referred to cowboys in terms of, I think you were referring to the inherent jurisdiction, Stephen, but anyway, cowboys is the phrase that comes to mind here, because this jurisdiction has been referred to as a lawless void in the not too distant past, because it appeared to have no parameters to it. But these two cases have very clearly underlined that there are parameters, and that the rule is that if a person doesn't lack mental capacity under the Mental Capacity Act, that they must be allowed to make their own decision. And it's only in quite specific circumstances that the court can intervene. And then just very briefly, what these cases were about was that PH was a person who had made the decision to stop taking nutrition. And a very thoughtful formulation was brought before the court of how the inherent jurisdiction might be triggered in order to try to gain more time for PH. But Mr. Justice Hayden was able to identify that the jurisdiction, in fact, could not be triggered. And the basic principles are set out in Re-SA of 2005 case of Sir James Mumby, which is referred to there in the passage that I've highlighted. And then finally, the case of EF, a case brought to court by Islington, who were exercising their safeguarding functions in relation to where EF had schizoaffective disorder, wanted to go and live in Brazil with a man who had a track record of possession of child pornography, allegedly, or there was some element of that being admitted to have been the case. There were lots of reasons why this person was not going to be good for EF. It was suggested or alleged that she was not able to make a free decision, free of his influence, to up sticks and go off to Brazil. The court found that, in fact, she was able to make that decision. It was an unwise decision, and that she had to be allowed to make it, although the court ended with a plea to her to listen to advice and not to pursue that very unwise decision. So thank you. That's everything for me. Stop sharing now.
Thanks so much, Bethan, for more points to look out for. And thank you for the questions that have come into the Q&A function, which we'll turn to in a moment. But first, I think the recording is going to be paused because for your judicial insights, and I think some of what you have touched upon answers, I think, at least one of the questions in the Q&A box. The question was in relation to welfare matters, where there is a delay because the official solicitor hasn't been able to satisfy the criteria in relation to costs. You've very succinctly provided the route via which that difficulty can be overcome. I think all of us are acutely aware of how overstretched the official solicitor is at the moment. And obviously ALRs have become more prominent as a result of that. So it's interesting to hear the way in which that may be taken forward. There are some other questions. I don't know if anybody on the panel wants to deal with them. I would just say that in relation to the most recent, or one of the most recent questions about who would want to observe a hearing and are there any restrictions, I think you have again, Judge, dealt with the issue of observations. The Open Justice Project, the Transparency Project, provides a lot of information for how people can contact courts. And I think there are researchers and students, as well as family members who may have cases going on separately, who want to see how it works, who make requests to observe those cases. Bethan hasn't come back. I don't know, Stephen, if you wanted to, if you've got any observations on, let's see, what do we have? One of the ones, I don't know if anyone on the screen has an observation, whether or not local authorities ought to be taking the lead where there is a family dispute regarding where it's in P's best interest to reside or receive care. Should the local authority be, whether or not P's a self-funder or not, should the local authority be doing something about that? It seems to me, unless anyone says any different, that where P is objecting to their current place of residence or the care arrangements, then that objection, once it's been reviewed and looked at, may well need to be brought to court. And if no one else is doing it, then it may be that the local authority do need to take some active steps to make sure that that is looked at. I'm conscious that we've gone over 6:30. I'm not cutting anyone else out if anyone else wants to speak. I don't know whether or not, Bethan, you've got any tips. The most recent question is, is there any guidance or any pitfalls regarding the local authority making the application for authority to sign the tenancy agreement on behalf of P? That's the most recent question in the Q&A box.
Yes. I mean, that sounds entirely right. The local authority should be stepping in under its basic Care Act, or ultimately safeguarding functions where P is not able to, or person lacking mental capacity obviously isn't able to manage their property and financial affairs. It does fall ultimately on the local authority to ensure that there is a mechanism in place for them to be able to manage them for, you know, their basic provisions such as their housing. So that would fall to the local authority. It would be appropriate for them to make that application.
Thanks, Bethan.